Good afternoon. So I would like to welcome you all also on behalf of the organizers. And I'm really glad that so many of us made this way here. And I'd like to say a few words about Estonia in the beginning as well. And as you probably have noticed, it's not so easy to get here, actually, in particular to Tartu. Since we do have international airport actually, but there is only one flight per day and it goes to Helsinki. But so here where we are now, capital is there, and a few figures about Estonia. So it's really a small country, and is the microphone working? It was okay. Okay. So I often when I compare Estonia, kind of to put it into a context, then it's really good to do it with these countries like Denmark and Netherlands, because we are all more or less similar with the size, and actually we are the biggest. But if you look at the number of people living, then actually there is four times more people in Denmark and over 10 times more people in Netherlands. So the main character is that there is quite a bit of space in Estonia and wild nature. And actually these numbers, these denote for the highest peaks of the country. And we study in school actually that we have actually four mountainous regions in Estonia. They are those who come from the countries where real mountains, of course, understand that this is kind of a joke. But anyways, our highest peak is here and it's called Egg Hill because it looks like an egg. I know that the Danes call theirs Himmelberget, which means a kind of a peak to the heaven or something. So, yeah. And the Netherlands is a little bit higher, but on the other hand, Estonian land is rising, and actually the height of our mountain was raised by 1 meter within last year. So maybe we will get closer and go further. So anyways, what the main thing is that we have a lot of wild nature in Estonia, and you can meet various animals, and it's a good destination for those interested in bird watching, for example. But if we move to the technologies, then if there is something kind of what everybody knows, then Skype was invented here. Although here is a trick again, because actually, as I understand, there are two more countries who say that they have invented Skype as well. It's Sweden and Denmark as well. Although, as I understand, in reality, the way it was, the Estonians did the program, but the Swedes and Danes got most of the money when it was sold to Microsoft. But I think our programmers, they became rich as well. But now moving to research, then within past few days, that was in the news, Clarity Analytics makes the kind of analysis of highly cited researchers. And maybe in Estonia we kind of turn too much attention to that, because I think there are several reasons why very good researchers sometimes do not never get to this list, because they do not collaborate so much or whatever reasons. But I understand that in some cases it is important and it is easy for research agencies and universities. And if we speak about Estonia, then it turns out that we have seven highly cited researchers, and actually over half of them are more or less related with plant biology, which is great. Then I made a comparison also with other countries, that what is the density of highly cited researchers, and it turns out that the density is higher in Denmark. There is a bit more highly cited researchers, but if we compare with Finland, then we are a little bit ahead. But then I actually made comparison with our other neighbor as well. Then we are a little bit in a better position. So most likely some things we've done right within past 25 years when the Soviet Union was ended. But on the other hand, when I come to the talk, or kind of the point of my talk, which is the Multicuvette systems for plant analysis, then this is very much related with Soviet Union space programs. Namely, if we speak about the Estonian school of plant biologists, then there are really several key figures of this school. Their background is physics. And the reason why their background is physics is that when the first satellites started to circulate around, and when all the kind of the space programs were launched, and then indeed there was a kind of serious battle between United States and Soviet Union, that who will kind of get more information more rapidly. And then soon it was also realized that these satellite images can be used to predict what could be the yield potentially. And that was one of the reasons why it was, when it was realized that this technology is needed, then the setting up this technology was started actually close to Tartu in the Institute of Astrophysics. And I think the father of this is Johan Ross, whose I think works are really well cited up to now. And then these are other figures like Agulaisk and Veloaja, who have been doing really excellent work in photosynthesis research, and Heino Moldau in stomata regulation, and Olevi Kull, Anu Sõber, and Bahtior Rasulov as well. So maybe not all of them are really worldwide known, but for us they are very important. And what is the same character for all these people is that the first education was physics. And as it usually is in case of physicists, that they, when they need to solve a problem, then they first develop or make a machine to do that. And we have been using this expertise very much and have been building instruments that can be used to monitor stomatal regulation and all over the plant behavior in a kind of semi-high throughput manner. So we started up by making systems for Arabidopsis, and our systems are Multicuvette systems, and compared to kind of other usual systems, when we started roughly 10 years ago, then there was actually no gas exchange analysis systems for Arabidopsis. And what is also different with our systems, that we can really change several conditions in these cuvettes independently. And that kind of enables really rapid analysis of plants. And here are a few images how it works. So what is one key difference, what is with our system, that we grow plants in a special pot, and there is a glass plate on top of a pot, and the plant grows through this pot, and then we measure gas exchange through the cuvette, and then can analyze it. So that's how it looks like in real life. So when the plant is small, it grows here, and then when it's later on in the cuvette, it looks like that. And that means that we can really rapidly change plants in the cuvette and kind of get information rapidly and do not need to touch the plant at all. And then we went further to make smaller systems for single leaf, and we have developed also platforms that enable creating different conditions under the microscope and measure them in electrophysiology as well directly in guard cells. And then we realized that we need bigger systems as well. And this is one cuvette system for which we is analyzed for Selaginella here. But more recent developments is that we've been making the multi-cuvette systems also that enable kind of parallel analysis of various cereals. And we have projects with wheat, barley, and rice going on. And we've been also helping other research institutions in Estonia and worldwide as well. And these are gas exchange systems that we have made that kind of automatically operate in the field, that they kind of automatically throughout the season collect the data and give quite good results. And we have made those such systems also for other universities in United States, Sweden, and Finland. And this is the one functioning in Hyytiala, Finland. And a little bit also about research of my group. So what we study is stomatal regulation. And stomata are small pores on the surfaces of plant leaves. And then they regulate how much water goes out and how much CO2 goes into the plant. And if we speak about stomatal opening and closure, then it's regulated by uptake and release of osmotically active ions into the guard cells. And that means that the kind of the key events of the signaling that we study is regulation of those ion channels and pumps that are in the guard cell membranes. And I think that guard cells are particularly exciting signaling system because they are kind of in the interface where they need to communicate the signals both inside the plant and also outside the environment. So that's why it's really exciting to study them. And they indeed play a major role, how much water goes out from the plant and kind of to develop plants that would use as minimally water as possible. This understanding those signaling systems is important. And here is just an example that, I mean, in wheat guard cells have to open to enable photosynthesis to take place, but from certain point on, further opening will not increase photosynthesis anymore. And then there is, they could be more open, and plant is kind of wasting water. And to illustrate that this really can take place, so here is two objects that we study. So this is the ecotype from Germany, Colombia, and this is the ecotype from Portugal. And if we look at the stomatal conductance of these plants, which illustrates how much water goes through the stomata, then as you see, this is two times different. So, and at the same time, the overall area, leaf area, is the same. So that means that the amount of biomass these plants produced is the same, but this plant most likely used two times more water for that than this one. So that kind of illustrates that there are reasons to find ways to regulate stomata that could be applied to breed crops that would be saving more water. And our overall kind of research strategy has been that we first identify plant lines that do not behave differently. They lack some specific reaction, and then we carry out all molecular biology approach down to the protein structure level to understand what is going on and what is behind this particular mutation that was present in this plant. And this is the kind of the signaling system of stomatal of the processes taking place in guard cells. And I just stop here by telling that the very important role is in guard cell ion channel SLAC1 that has to be activated. And SLAC1 activation goes through phosphorylation by different protein kinases. And the activity of these protein kinases in turn are controlled by type 2C protein phosphatases, which are controlled by the plant hormone abscisic acid. So kind of understanding or setting this scheme, how it works, and what is the importance of this signaling in stomatal regulation in different environmental conditions, these our systems have been really instrumental in finding this all out. And to put it into the context, so here is wild-type plant that has not been watered for 10 days, and here is SLAC1 mutant, the plant line that lacks the ion channel. And then when we rewater them, the wild type is doing quite well, but SLAC1 plants do not do well. So it is important as well in a kind of real drought situations. And I'd like to finish up with few words about our recent findings about guard cell CO2 signaling. So CO2 is indeed the main function of stomatal pores is to open. The pore has to open in order to let CO2 come in and photosynthesis to start. And CO2, when CO2 concentration is decreasing, then stomata open because plant interpret this as a signal that there is a lack of substrate for photosynthesis and stomata open. Vice versa, when CO2 concentration increases, stomata are closing. And it's actually interesting how this project was going on, because it was actually carried out by different graduate students and different graduate students in different countries. And we can call it kind of all roads really led to Rome in the end. So one project we had, we were characterizing one ozone-sensitive mutant that we called Su. Su means mouth in Estonian, and indeed it had a big mouth. And then the other line was from Cape Verde Islands, and we did QTL analysis of this line, and then we had one CO2 insensitive mutant. And then there were, yes, people involved in that as well, Hanna Hörak, Lina Jakobson, different graduate students. And what turned out that this plant line had a mutation in HT1 kinase, and these two plants had a mutation in MPK12 kinase. And as it turned out, these MPK12 and MPK4 were controlling the activity of HT1, and that in turn was then regulating the stomatal movements in response to changes in CO2 concentration. And indeed, we needed more power to resolve this. There was another graduate student, Kadri Tõltsep, who is a good biochemist, and Shu Wang postdoc to clarify this project. And it was a collaboration with Mikael Brochet from University of Helsinki and actually other groups from China and the United States as well. So in turn, yes, what we could show is that there is a signaling system that is really highly CO2 specific. And if that does not work, there is not a single guard cell movement in response to changes in CO2 that controls HT1. And this in turn controls activation of anion channel and stomatal opening and closure mechanisms. And what is particularly exciting is that we have identified in this signaling system point mutations by which we can either open stomata or close stomata and then abolish the CO2 regulation. And this is here illustrated also by the changes or differences in water use efficiency. And we think that this is really kind of has a high potential to be modulated, and we already have proved that the same thing works in tomato and are currently making tomato lines where this is this will be changed and are doing the same in case of rice as well. So yeah, with that, so the conclusion or the main message I wanted to say, so it's a technology session that we've been developing the multicuvette systems in Tartu, and I think we've been quite successful in building those. And we've been making those to others as well. So if you're interested, please contact me or us. And we are also ready to kind of we have been doing a lot of collaboration service to others. So if you're interested in analyzing your lines, then please come and we can discuss it and either do it as a collaboration or somehow differently. And yes, such research that from kind of the multicuvette gas exchange systems to protein structure level, I would say has been successful, and I'm very pleased with that, and I'd like to finish with that slide where our people who have been doing their job. So thank you very much.